Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Hello. I'm sorry to interrupt conversation. I hope that's not the only reason you come to worship here. So anyway, again, good morning and welcome to this time of worship. And I welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. If you are watching on Facebook or YouTube later, we are especially glad that you're here and invite comments during the service. For those of you that are here, we're glad you're here. We have some announcements. Bill?
Glad to see all you guys back. We really appreciate your coming. And we just want to announce that Rebuilding Together, the next church mission project, will occur September 9th through the 12th. Should be a lot of fun. We're assembling teams to work on two houses. Thanks to Don Burgess, our house captain, the houses conveniently are right next to each other, and they're only about two blocks from the church. So I think it's going to be a good weekend. We're having a volunteer organizational meeting right after today's service in the Weaver Room. Pick up some coffee and pastries on the way out the door and come upstairs to the Weaver Room. And Roger Randall will be there, who's the Secretary Treasurer of Rebuilding Together. He's going to orient us towards the organization. We did this a year ago, but we had to shut down due to COVID. I think it's going to be a fun project. If you're at all interested, come to the meeting. If you've already volunteered, come to the meeting. We'll do some further explanation, details. We have some forms to sign where volunteers will list what skills they have, if any. If you don't have skills, you just hold me there, we can still use you. So the meeting, as I say, right after the service in the Weaver Room. Thanks very much.
Good morning, I'm Tony Neal, and you will see my name in the worship folder you have today as leading worship, and obviously you'll see Judy being the one doing that. So Judy had planned to be out of town for some family issues there, and when her trip was delayed, she took back leading worship today, and just, I'm glad she did. So we're thankful for your leadership. Take note of the announcements in your bulletin. There's several things going on, especially want to highlight the picnic for you. That's the 28th. We hope you will choose to be a part of that. It's going to be a fun gathering that's catered, but we need to hear from you that you want to participate. We also have the upcoming retreat in September, always a special event in the life of our church, and we invite and encourage any of you who want to be a part of that to opt in and be a part. If you didn't get an email from me this week for Seasoned and Spirited, it means I don't have you on my email list. So if you want to be a part of getting those announcements, you need to email me and tell me I want to be added to that list. We have three upcoming events, one the end, next Sunday evening, the final concert at Baker Park. September, there's a crab picking. October, we're gathering for some pre-Halloween activities and having a good time together in costume. So I need to hear from you for the first two events as quickly as possible, especially if you're interested in transportation for the crab pick, which is going to be in La Plata, Maryland. So let me know, and we look forward to hearing from you. Thanks.
Thank you, and let us worship God. Would you join me in the call to worship? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Though storms rage around me, I will clothe myself with the whole armor of God. I will place strength and determination as my shoes to aid me in my ministry and mission for God. I will pray diligently at all times, offering prayers and supplication to God. Be strong in the Lord who provides for your every need. Let us pray. God, our strength, you have brought us into this holy place through Christ, who has the words of eternal life. As you made us alive by his flesh and blood, cause us to boldly witness to the gospel. Welcome the stranger and pursue peace, standing through the struggles of our times. Through Jesus Christ, in union with the Holy Spirit, we praise you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated. Because God is near to the brokenhearted, let us consider how we have lived, confessing our sins and trusting in God's mercy to save. O Lord, you are near to the brokenhearted, and you save the crushed in spirit. Be near to us in our brokenness, and love us into wholeness. You are near to people who are hurting, but we keep our distance to avoid conflict. You envision a world where all needs are met, but we hoard our possessions and cling to our power. And love us into wholeness. By your mercy, forgive our sins. By your grace, free us to try again. Amen. Listen to the good news. Hope in God. For God's love has no ending. God fills us with grace and hope this day and forever. God hears our voice and listens to our prayers, redeeming us from all our sins. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Having confessed and being reassured and assured that you are forgiven, let us celebrate the peace of Christ. If you are comfortable with touching, be comfortable, but if you are not, simply hold your hands together. The peace of Christ be with you. Let us exchange signs of peace. While we don't have little ones to come forward, we do have a couple youth over there, but I would invite you to be young at heart for just a moment. And for the children that are at home, if you would get your backpacks, or at least be thinking about them if you don't want to run and get them, but we focus on your backpacks for a little bit. I borrowed a backpack because I don't use one right now. A backpack is a tool that our kids use to carry things for the work of learning. So help me here. What kinds of things are in a backpack for children? I'm sorry? I still can't hear. A cell phone? All right. What else? Pencils, yes. I have a pencil box. And it has in the pencil box writing implements, glue stick, an eraser. You know, we need those things for learning. Okay, what else? Crayons. I don't have crayons, but y'all know what they look like. All right, what else? All right, so we have a ruler. We have notebooks. At some point, the kids will be coming home with homework. Whoops. And then they'll also have fumbles. There are textbooks. And unfortunately, but healthily, we now have masks. These are tools that represent the things that the kids need to learn with. Not only that, but the parents, the teachers, the administrators, bus drivers, cafeteria people, all the adults, including parents, that support learning. We have for the children and youth, we have backpack tags. And there are tags, a little bit different size print for youth and children. But the tags and the stickers say, go out in peace and be led back in peace. I'm sorry, go out in joy and be led back in peace. We invite children or parents to let the office know who wants these, and they'll be mailed out. Those of you that are here, you can pick them up before you leave. And the idea is that they will remember God as they carry their backpack, and also that they will remember the community of faith that keeps them in prayer. So I urge you to do that. Let us pray. God of wisdom and knowledge, we ask for blessings on the backpacks and the children who wear them. May this be a good school year for them. Sustain and strengthen them for the joys and challenges of learning. As we go through our days, may we know your presence and strength. May these tags help us remember you are always near. Bless our children and the adults in their lives and keep them. Let your face shine upon them and be gracious to them. Lift up your countenance upon them and give them peace. Amen.
Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to the people, "Now, therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served before, beyond the river, and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us all along the way that we went and among the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Taste.
Our second reading is from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly, as I must speak. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
A reading from John chapter 6. Jesus said, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever." He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then, what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one who would betray him. And he said, 'For this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father.' Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, 'Do you also wish to go away?' Simon Peter answered him, 'Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God.'" The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Some of you might remember a weekly NPR radio show on Saturday nights in the late 70s and 80s called A Prairie Home Companion. It featured the stories of the citizens of Lake Wobegon, a fictional Scandinavian town in Minnesota, where all the women are strong, all the men are good looking, and all the children are above average. The opening words of the monologue usually were something about, "Well, it's been a quiet week in Lake Wobegon, Minnesota, my hometown." And the audience would clap their hands because they knew a wonderful story was coming. For some of us, this week, this past week, has not been a quiet week. School started in Frederick. COVID cases rose with a corresponding increase in hospitalizations. Some local places had flooding, while globally there was an earthquake in Haiti, wildfires out west, and chaos in Afghanistan. The list goes on. This week for my sister, it was not a quiet week. Her husband died. We made funeral arrangements. Tony agreed to preach, and the funeral was postponed. And so I was still in town and said, "I'm still here." And Tony said, "Well, go ahead." And so thank you, Tony. The list of things that make it a not quiet week goes on and on, and it is easy to become overwhelmed and discouraged. There was a prayer on the Presbyterian website that I would like to share. "God of mercy, as wildfires and wars rage, earthquakes shake the planet, tropical storms threaten, we are at a loss as to what to say or do. In these moments of anguish and fear and grief, we turn to you in prayer, Holy God. confident that you hear the cries of your people. As we send our daughters back to school, free to raise their hands in class, free to study and to speak, we pray for the daughters of Afghanistan. We pray for women shrouding themselves in fear, for liberties recently gained to hold despite the new oppressive regime. We pray for the Afghani men, fathers, brothers, sons, uncles, desperately seeking refuge for their families. We pray for all the Afghani people whose lives are trapped in a war zone. We pray for American troops morally torn over leaving this country and their service behind. Lord, have mercy. Turn us from violence as a justified means for achieving our ends. Guide humanity toward your path of peace. In your mercy, God, hear also our prayers for Haiti. Why, O God, have the people of Haiti suffered so? How long, O Lord, must your people on this island endure tragedy after tragedy? We pray for this nation rocked by economic crisis, political assassination, a spiraling pandemic, and now an earthquake causing death and destruction. We grieve for your beloved ones and cry out on their behalf. Rescue the people of Haiti, God, desperate for help. Protect them from the next deluge heading their way, from the flooding and the mudslides. Guide us in global mission so our efforts might provide relief and support. Great God, you know us so well. You know our pain. You know our loss. You grieve with us as wildfires consume homes and COVID-19 fills hospital beds. You cry with us as tragedies plague your people. You work beside us in ministry and mission. God of grace, open our eyes, hearts, and hands to the movement of your Spirit in this broken world. Restore hope to the suffering. Mend the hearts of the hurting. Grant us all the strength to support those in need. As we forgive, as we forage for hope along the path of tragedy, may we bear the good fruit of faith, turning to each other and to you in love. Restore us, Holy God, with your hope. We pray this in the name of Christ. Amen. Some of us know paths of sorrow and fear, loss and chaos in the past months and weeks and days. And we pray again as we forage for hope along the path of tragedy. May we bear the good fruit of faith, turning to each other and to you in love. Restore us, Holy God, with your hope. In times like these, not only do I need a God of compassion and hope, I need a warrior God. Some of us need a warrior who will protect and fight for us. We have battles with addiction and anxiety and depression and disease and regret and rage and guilt and financial problems and relationship problems. Now, I admit I am really uncomfortable with passages in the Bible that have God asking or commanding that people die, with images of God as a God of war and violence. But sometimes I need a reminder that our God is a mighty God, a mighty fortress, a bulwark never failing, a helper amid the flood of mortal ills. who has the power and might to prevail against that ancient foe. For Paul, in the letter to the Ephesians, that foe is not a person that we call enemy. Paul says, "For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places." Paul urges us to both depend on God and use the resources that God has given us. When we were baptized or when we joined the church, we are asked this question: do you renounce the powers of evil and seek the freedom of new life in Christ? We say yes, I know I did, and then I forget the question and I go out for a meal after church. So we seldom think about what we have just said yes to. We seldom think about what this means to how we live, to live in and into the kingdom of God. It's not enough to renounce evil. Paul and I think Jesus want us to be active in seeking justice and loving kindness and working to make a difference. Pastor June Boatwell puts it this way: it is easy to be overwhelmed by the pain of the world. We want to turn off the evening news and tune out the stories of human suffering. At least I do. But God calls us to pay attention to those around us, to do more than simply give to worthy causes, to do more than pray the situation into God's hands. Our faith is to be lived out in righteous actions, that we might resist wickedness and avoid condemnation for our lack of compassion. We are challenged to meet the needs of others, to reach out with hand and heart, to provide for the real human needs of others. Now, if you have ever been involved in disaster recovery, whether from a natural disaster or a financial, housing, or health crisis, you know how draining that recovery work is. And it is easy to get overwhelmed and tired. Maybe you haven't had a crisis. Maybe what you have is a slow chipping away of energy, patience, and kindness by the everyday things in life that drain you. But wait, Paul says, don't give up. Put on the armor of God. Stand firm. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of God's power. God has given us resources to keep going and to fight the good fight, not the least of which is the gift of the Holy Spirit. A few minutes ago, we blessed backpacks and children. We discussed the tools and resources that would go into the backpack to be used every day. What if we imagined our own God-given backpack that holds those resources that God intends for us to use every day? Paul uses imagery of a Roman soldier's armor, a belt, breastplate, shoes, shield, helmet, and sword. And note that all but one item is for protection and not attack. Now, Paul renames those items for the warrior, for the soldier. So we have tools in our own backpack. We have the gospel of peace. We have salvation. We have righteousness or right relationships. We have prayer. We have faith. Now, sometimes we have doubts, but we have faith that gets us through. We have truth. We sang in the first hymn, God's truth will abide. We have supplication, prayers for others. And we have the Word of God. We have scripture and we have the words of comfort and encouragement from each other, words that God uses as a tool. If we use these resources in our backpack, if we leave those resources in our backpack, they don't do us any good. We have to take them out and put them on to use them in daily decisions, conversations, acts of kindness and generosity. We adults may not be putting on a backpack to go to school, but we can put on the armor of God to go into our days. Be strong in the Lord and in the strength of God's power. Let the refrain of your heart and life be, here on Jesus Christ I will stand. He's the solid rock of my life. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Let us pray. God, who weaves the world together in wisdom, give us even the tiniest taste of that wisdom. Our lives are flooded with words, with news stories of bigotry, hatred, violence, and suffering. With tweets and posts that dice our days into tiny bites that turn to sawdust in our mouths, leaving us ravenous. With the emotions of whiplash, of announcements, policies, and press conferences, reigniting the anxiety and the anger. So many words swirl around us and overwhelm us. And we do what feels safest to us, which is to form action plans and mission statements, as if our words will make this flood of our time obey us. As if our words will calm the floodwaters of grief within us. Underneath all of these words, these efforts of ordering what can't be ordered and explaining what can't be explained, of performing our lives for the consumption of others rather than living them, there is a common word, fear. We are afraid of our own mortality. We are afraid we are meaningless. We are afraid we will revert into our smaller, sadder selves of 15 or so months ago. So when we ask for your wisdom to come amidst all this noise and all this fear, we must also ask that you come in a way that will catch our attention, in a way we cannot plan, organize, schedule, or commodify. You will have to surprise us. You who came not as a mighty monarch to establish your reign over lesser people, but as a curious child. You will have to weave your wisdom into the spaces between all the words, the chaos of our days. And maybe, if you are as good as you say you are, if you are as good as we say you are, you will even bring wisdom through joy. Joy that sends that fear away empty and fills up every crack of these fractured lives of ours to the brim, and overflows with a deep knowledge, a wisdom of your goodness toward us, and our capacity to be good to each other. May it be so. And now, O Lord, hear us as we pray with one voice the prayer that was taught to us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of yours, now and forever. Amen. This is our worship time of giving. And we give both because we have much to be grateful for and because the giving itself molds us into generous people. It teaches us a path marked not by risk management, but by overflowing grace. Let us worship God. Thank you. Let us pray. Generous God, we have so much to thank you for. Help us to have generous hearts and hands. Add your blessing to our gifts, that they may multiply in ways far beyond us, establishing your kingdom of peace and plenty. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. May God, who creates, redeems, and sustains, keep you steadfast in faith, alive with hope, and abounding in love. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Equipped now for the work of ministry, go in peace and be bread for the life of the world. Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God.